Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare.
Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Gopi Jana Vallabha Giribhara Thari. Jaya Gopi Jana Vallabha Giribhara Thari. Sharanandana Raja Jana Ranjana Sharanandana Raja Jana Ranjana Tira Vanachadi Shamuna Tira Vanachadi Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Gopi Jana Vallabha Giribhara Thari. Sharanandana Gaja Jana Ranjana Sharanandana Raja Jana Ranjana Jamuna Tira Vanachari Jamuna Tira Vanachari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Jaya Gopi Jana Vallabha Giribhara Thari Jaya Yashoda Nandana Raja Jana Ranjana Shamuna Tida Vanashadi Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihadi Jai Om Vishnu Bhad, Paraman Supari Vrajaka Charja, Ashto Uttara Sarasvi Shimad, A.C. Bhakti Vedanta Swami Maharaj, Prabhupada Ki Jai, Iskan Samsthapaka Charja, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai, Ananta Koti Vaishnavinda Ki Jai, Nama Charja, Srila Haridas Thakur Ki Jai, Prem Sikaho, Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda, Sri Advaita Gadadhar, Shiva Shadi Gaur Bhakta Vrindaki Jai Sri Sri Radha Krishna Gokopinath Sham Kun Radha Kundigiri Govardhan Ki Jai Vrindavan Tham Ki Jai Navadip Tham Ki Jai Jagannath Puri Ki Jai Gangamai Ki Jai Jamanamai Ki Jai Tulsi Devi Ki Jai Bhakti Devi Ki Jai Samaveta Bhakta Vrindaki Jai All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. Gaur Premanande Hari Hari Gaur. Thank you all very much for coming. We need to make this a little higher. Hare Krishna. We invite you to check your cell phone and see that it's in silent mode. Pocket cameras in the pocket. Om Gaanati Mirantasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurn Militam Jena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manopistam Sthapitam Jena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadam Mahyam Dadhati Shapadatikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Jutapada Kamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Shagrajatam Shagana Raganatan Vitamstam Sajiva Sadvaitam Savatutam Pradijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Shagana Lalita Sri Vishakan Vitamstra He Krishna Kuruna Sindho Dina Bandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kamsana Gaurangi Radhe Brindavaneshwari Prashabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Pancha Kolpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhobhye Vacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Nama Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivashadi Gaur Bhaktivinoda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare Where did Adam, could I ask you for that hoodie? Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare. Oh, get the whole deck. That's good enough. Put it back. Good. Makes all the difference in the world. Shinvatam Svakata Krishna Punya Shavana Kirtana Hridyantasto Hyabhadrani Vidhunoti Suhritsatam. Is that good? Seems like however you adjust it, it remains the same. Oh, it's that one. I see. That's for up and down. Okay. Give it a loosen. The other way. Counterclockwise. And if we hold it right there, it's going to be good. Except it droops, but that's pretty good now. Srinvatam Swakata Krishna. Krishna Kata means subject matters, Krishna subject matters. Kata means subject for discussion. Srinvatam Swakata Krishna Punya Shravana Kirtana. Just to hear Krishna Kata or to speak Krishna Kata is purifying. Hridyantasto Yabhadrani Vidhunoti Suhritsatam. In the heart, there are so many unwanted things. In this material world, our hearts are not pure. There are so many things in the heart that we wish weren't there. So many anxieties, so many desires, so many frustrations, so many angry thoughts, so much junk. It's like a junkyard. But vidhunoti suhrit satam. Suhrit satam means the best friend of the devotees. Suhrit means a heart-to-heart friend. There are different words in Sanskrit for friend, bandhu, mitra. Suhrit means a heart-to-heart friend. So the best friend of the devotees, and in fact the best friend of everyone, is Krishna. And when Krishna sees that someone is hearing about him, speaking about him, then he becomes pleased, naturally. If someone is speaking about us favorably, then naturally we become enlivened. Oh, he's talking about me. So that's originally in Krishna. And especially because he's the father of all living entities, so he desires to have a loving relationship with all the living beings who are part of him. He desires the living beings to be happy by reviving that relationship. You mean you're not interested in a long lecture? I can't believe it. So vidhunoti means he purifies the heart. Krishna himself is all pure, and when he enters the heart, he can purify the heart of all unwanted things. Abhadrani, yes. They're also called abhadrani, unwanted things in the heart. So, Hridyantasto Yabhadrani Vidhunoti Suhritsatam. So, Krishna cleanses the heart, and when the heart is purified, one tada rajas tado tamo bhava kamalopadayasthe. One becomes freed from passion and ignorance. You know that there are three qualities of material nature: goodness, passion, and ignorance. Well, goodness is the platform of peace and happiness, materially speaking. passion is the mode for desires and hard work. It's strenuous endeavor. And ignorance is the mode for laziness, sleep, intoxication, badness, foolishness. Unfortunately, passion and ignorance play a large part in our hearts or in the world. But by Krishna Katha, Krishna subject matters, the kama index, the passion index, and the ignorance index are lowered. Tada rajas tamo bhava kama. And along with that, lusty desires, longing and longing, and kama and lobe. Lobe means greed. Kama and adiye. Adi means so. That's just the start. Lust, greed, anger, madness, envy, illusion. All of these reside in the heart, and they're like, this is the real heart disease. You know, sometimes you see there are campaigns for heart disease, stop heart disease. But this is the real heart disease, that all of these things are clogging the heart. So, tada rajas tamo bhava kama lopadiyas chaite taranavittam stitam sattve prasidati. When the passion and ignorance are diminished, naturally goodness comes to the fore, and one becomes satisfied. One becomes happy-minded. Evam prasanna manasa. Evam prasanna manaso bhagavat bhakti yogata. By being situated in devotional service to Krishna, bhagavat tattva vijnanam, one comes to understand the science of Krishna. Bhagavat tattva. It's not just a sentiment. Oh, Krishna is so wonderful. I love Krishna. That's all right. But there's a science to understand what is what. Who is Krishna? Who are we in relationship to Krishna? What is this world and what is its relationship to Krishna? What is our relationship to this world? All of these subjects are worthy of understanding. We want to understand so many things, but these are the essential things to understand Krishna and our relationship with Krishna. So that, and the result of understanding that Krishna science is mukta sangasya jayate. One becomes freed from material entanglement. Mukta sangasya jayate. So this Krishna katha is of two kinds. There's Krishna katha spoken by Krishna and Krishna katha spoken about Krishna. The spoken by Krishna is Bhagavad Gita. The Bhagavad Gita is the preliminary science of Krishna tattva. Spoken by Krishna himself. That's one kind of Krishna katha. And the other is spoken about Krishna. This Srimad Bhagavatam is spoken about Krishna. Actually, there's no difference, spoken by Krishna or spoken about Krishna. But from another point of view, we can say it's of two kinds, spoken by, spoken about. Well, the Srimad Bhagavatam, especially, is Krishna Katha spoken about Krishna. The Srimad Bhagavatam is written Mahamuni Krite by Mahamuni Vyasadeva, the author of all the Vedic literature, in his maturity. He's known as the compiler of the Vedas, the author of Vedanta Sutra, the compiler of the Puranas.
the author of Mahabharata. So many works. But after compiling all of these works, he found that he was dissatisfied. So he was wondering, I've written so many books for the enlightenment of people, for the philosophers, I've written Vedanta Sutra, for people in general, I've written Mahabharata. Why am I not satisfied? And just at that time, his spiritual master, Narad Muni, appeared on the scene.
Could I get a little water?
It's where?
Hidden where? Oh, of course. I should have seen it. His spiritual master, Narad Muni, appeared on the scene. If you move forward a little, the backcomers can have room. Thank you. So, Vyasadeva explained his problem. I've written so many books, still I'm not satisfied. Narad said, yes, because you haven't glorified Krishna. You've spoken indirectly. You've given abstruse philosophical ideas in Vedanta Sutra. You've given so many stories in Mahabharata, love stories, adventure stories, moral instructions, so many different things. Biggest book in the world. You put the Iliad and the Odyssey together, multiplied times 5, I think, and you get the size of Mahabharata. A very big book. And full of, it said, whatever's not in Mahabharata isn't there anywhere. So, but it's all, for the most part, indirect. To attract people's attention, and then within the Mahabharata they'll get Bhagavad Gita, but Bhagavad Gita is only 18 chapters in this enormous book. So Narad instructed that the problem is that you haven't directly focused in on Krishna. So all of your moral instructions and philosophical analysis, it will just agitate people's minds. It will be like their minds will be like boats rocking in the water, and your books are, you know, the wind. So your people's minds are already agitated, you're agitating them more. What's the use of all your books? You're encouraging them. You're encouraging people by encouraging them to be moral and to be ethical and religious and so on. You're really just encouraging them in their material life. To lead a better material life, a more righteous material life, but material life. That means you've misled them. You've misled them. The material activities don't look very good without the touch of bhakti yoga or connection with divinity, with the personality of Godhead. So Vyasadeva took the clue and he meditated and he saw the personality of Godhead along with his material energy. Krishna means with Krishna's energies. The whole material world is a manifestation of Krishna's energy. The spiritual world is a manifestation of Krishna's energy. We living beings are also part of Krishna's spiritual energy. Everything that exists is part of Krishna's energy. So Vyasadeva saw this, and in his mature stage,
he compiled Srimad Bhagavatam. Krishne svatam opagate jnana dharmadi bhisaha kalo nashtra drishami sha puranar godinodita. It's in the Kali Yuga, this is the present time, Kali Yuga, the age of darkness. In this age of darkness, Krishna is no longer present. Krishna was present 5,000 years ago. Then he left and returned to the spiritual world. But in the physical absence of Krishna, Krishna is again present in the sound vibration of Srimad Bhagavatam. So the Mahamuni Vyasadeva wrote Srimad Bhagavatam to specifically describe Krishna, speak about Krishna, enlighten people in the science of Krishna. The Vedyam Vastavam Atra Vastu Shivanam. Vastavam Atra Vastu Shivanam. The Bhagavatam distinguishes or enables us to distinguish between reality and illusion. The problem of material life is that we can't distinguish between reality and illusion. We become captivated by that which is temporary, by that which has no substantial permanent existence, and we lose sight of our eternal nature, of the soul. We become more preoccupied with the body. Body means my body, my country, my family, my wife, my husband, my children, my parents, so many mys, my car, my house. Janasya mohoya maham mamiti. I become bewildered by thinking of myself as the body and thinking of these things as mine. So Krishna consciousness means to understand that higher than the body or entirely different from the body, is the soul. Nasato vidite bhavo na bhavo vidite sata. The body is temporary, but the soul within the body is eternally existing. And my real identity is that I'm not this body, I'm the soul within the body. And that soul, now I've formed a false relationship with matter. I've taken on this material body and I'm interested in material things, material relationships. Material means temporary. But bhakti yoga means to revive my spiritual nature and my eternal relationship with the absolute, with the personality of Godhead, with Krishna. And Shivanam, that will be beneficial. We're looking for something beneficial, something that will be good for us. But we don't know the ultimate good. The ultimate good is there in Krishna. And tapa trayo namulanam, this ultimate knowledge of Krishna, will uproot the miseries of material existence. Material world is a place where there are miseries, unavoidably, from nature, from other living beings, from the body and the mind. But all of these miseries can be uprooted by an understanding of Krishna and the science of Krishna. So it was for this purpose that Srila Vyasadeva wrote, finally, Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam has 12 cantos. The first 9 cantos describe the different truths that are dependent on Krishna. And the 10th canto directly describes Krishna himself, along with his qualities, his entourage, his pastimes, everything. It's not vague that God is a force, God is beyond words, beyond... No, Bhagavatam directly delineates describes the form, qualities, pastimes, everything of Krishna. So these two books are very important, Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. Therefore, Srila Prabhupada focused on these two books. He wrote his translation and commentary, Bhagavad Gita as it is, and he made his life work the presentation of Srimad Bhagavatam. He could have done it in a short space, just translate the verses. It's not that big. 12 cantos, it would fit in a couple of volumes. But Srila Prabhupada presented it with elaborate commentary, with the original Sanskrit, with the word-for-word meanings for each verse, then with a translation and a rich commentary to enable us to understand the meaning of Srimad Bhagavatam. Because each verse has unlimited meaning. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu once was asked to explain one verse, Atmaramaschamuniyo, and he described it, giving 64 different meanings. This word can mean this, or this, or this, or this, or this, or this. This word can mean this, or this, or this, or this. This next word can mean this, or this, or this, or this. When you put all these words together, you can get this meaning, or this meaning, or this meaning, or this meaning. Gave 64 different meanings for one verse. Later, Sanatana Goswami met Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and after some discussion, he said, I heard that you described this verse in 64 different ways. Could you please describe it to me? And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu described it 64 different ways. And then he said, oh, by your association, I just thought of another way. Another meaning. But then he said, actually, there's unlimited meaning because each word is Krishna himself. Each word is Krishna himself, and Krishna is unlimited. So in each verse of Srimad Bhagavatam, Krishna is there, or unlimited meaning is there. And therefore, Prabhupada gave commentary to help us appreciate and relish and be enlightened by Srimad Bhagavatam. Maybe I'll stop here and see what questions there might be. Yes?
You just say this. Each word means 64 meanings, so Prabhupada gave one meaning.
No, in the purport he outlines it, that this word can mean this or this. Prabhupada sketches out the meaning given by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu.
Okay.
So that's the beauty of it, that in the translation you'll only get one meaning, but when you go to the commentary you could find out that it could mean this, it can mean this, it can mean this, from different angles of vision.
Okay. So I put different angles on the purport.
Mm.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Yes.
Hello. Thank you very much for the lecture. My question is about the beginning of the soul journey. In Srimad Bhagavatam, it says that our souls came from the spiritual world where we initially already have the relationship with the God and its endless expansion of love. And one of the reasons why we are in this material world, because at some moment the soul decided that it wants to try to live without God. And at that moment our soul were placed in this material world. So and once we by lucky chance we got freed and come back to the spiritual world, and we're waking as from the bad dream, determined not to come back again. But I was wondering, I didn't find any answer to the question, why initially the soul who has got Satchit and Ananda wants to come this material world and try to live without God. This is the main reason why it is all happening. If it's already has got the knowledge and relationship with God and endless happiness. Thank you.
In Srimad Bhagavatam it said, from pure consciousness, contaminated consciousness arises. From pure consciousness, contaminated consciousness arises. As independent living beings, or as living beings with tiny independence, we always have the ability to turn toward Krishna or away from Krishna. That's called marginal. We can be like just like the sand on the beach. It can be in the water, or it can be on the land. So the living entity can be in Krishna consciousness or out of Krishna consciousness. That's up to him. We can't trace a time. In the spiritual world, there's no time in the spiritual world. There's no past, present, and future. You can't trace out at such and such time that this happened, that happened. Therefore, it said, Anadi Kalse. Since time immemorial, the living beings in this world have turned away from Krishna. We'll not be able to find when did this happen, how did this happen. But here we are. And our position is like that of a man drowning.
Is it because of just the soul wanted to wonder how it has been without the God?
You can't trace. Did he wonder? Did he want? Did he become this, that? Somehow or other.
So you imagine if we go back to the spiritual world and we decide again,
don't
live free.
First go. Krishna says, Yadgatvana nivartante tadhama paramamama. You go there, you won't come back. Don't be in anxiety that if I go, I'll have to come back.
I read that. It's just, I was confused if initially we are from there and we come here and then we go back and then, is it because...
Don't worry.
The soul
says, Mahasuchaha, don't worry about it, that you'll have to come back.
I was just wondering about the reason why this all happened, just because of
Prabhupada
one
called it
moment.
Causeless unwillingness to serve Krishna.
Thank you.
There's no good reason. It's unreasonable.
All right. Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. Hare Krishna Maharaj. Thank you for a nice lecture. My question is... you said earlier that it is our hearts are so dirty, and it's our hearts are so dirty, filled with so many things. Mm. For me, I'm always wondering that it's going to not take one lifetime, but it's going to take so many lifetimes to cleanse our hearts. So without cleansing our hearts, we are not going to be able to go back to Godhead. Mm. Sometimes, you know, Prabhupada says that, you know, if you do chanting and reading and everything, you will go back to Godhead. But for me, I keep on thinking, our hearts are so dirty, how are we going to clean it in one lifetime?
There is
no chance for us to go back.
How are we going
back,
to go back
it?
In one lifetime? There are two things. If it takes a few lifetimes, that's not bad. You know, if people, they'll wait for like, what? It used to be to get a telephone in India, you'd wait for like 3 years. You'd think it was worth waiting for, because then you got a telephone. If I can wait for 3 years for a telephone, how long can I wait to go back to Godhead? It's worth it. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had one associate, Mukunda, was it?
Mukunda.
Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's devotee, but somehow or other, he went off and was hearing from the Mayavadis. So then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu expelled him. Tell him not to come. I don't want to see him. Nothing to do with it. So then he was despondent that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has kicked me out. I can't have his association. I'm banned. He was hoping, when will I get his association? So finally he asked Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's secretary, please ask Lord Chaitanya, when can I have his association again? So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said that Mukunda, he can have my association after 1,000 births. So the secretary went, reported that Mahaprabhu said, you know, after 1,000 births you can have his association. And then Mukunda began to dance. 1,000 births! At least I'll get his association again. Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu heard about this. He said, all right, come on. So even if it takes more than one, but Prabhupada said, no, in one birth we can do everything. If one chants Hare Krishna, it's stated in Shastra, if one chants Hare Krishna purely, even once, one can get free from more sins than one is able to commit. Not by our own capability, but by Krishna's mercy. What is that? Nachurat parta maya beshuta chetasa. That bag went where? Oh, it went all the way to the back again. In the, let's see where we find it, 12th chapter, I think. Let's see where that's going to be. Yeah, okay, you can look it up and see who's first. Nachirat parta maya veshita chetasa. See, I thought it was 12, and then I looked in 12 and didn't see it. And then I thought. Ah, there it is, 7. Yay, 2 surjus. For one who dedicates all his work to me, always thinking of me, for him, I am the swift deliverer. Tesham aham samudharta mrityu samsara sagara. I quickly pick him up from the ocean of birth and death. Bhavami nachirat parta. Not after a long time. Quickly. Maya veshita chetasam. Because he's always thinking of me.
But this is the hardest thing, isn't it? To think of Krishna all the time. It's not always possible, is it?
That's why we have Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. So that we can think of Krishna all the time. There's just like there's so much, you know, there's the Times of London, there's the Economist, there's, you know, a lot of stuff published in London every day, and people are talking about it, people are thinking about it. What about Princess this? What about Princess that? What about this? What about that? What about so many things? And their minds are spinning with all these mundane topics. This person murdered that person. This one's accusing that one of this. This one's stolen that. This one's been brought to court. This one's... So, all these subject matters, because the mind is going on thinking and thinking of so many things. So, therefore, there's Krishna Katha. Krishna subject matter, so that by hearing this Krishna Katha, our mind becomes diverted to Krishna. The topics of Krishna are more relishable and satisfying. You know, you read the newspaper. Who here reads the newspaper and then puts it down after you know, 10 minutes or half an hour or whatever it is, puts it down and says, that was so good. Who feels at the end of reading the newspaper, wow, was that ever satisfying? That has brought such joy to my heart. No. We put it down and we feel worse than when we picked it up. So much is in the heart, or so much is in the mind from reading, but it just adds to the weight, it adds to the troubles, it adds to the contamination. But when we read Srimad Bhagavatam, the heart becomes joyful. Also in Bhagavad Gita, what is that? Anurajyate cha. This is the 11th chapter. Let's find it. Tava stane hrishikesha. Tava prakirtya jagat prahishyanti. Anurajyate cha. My dear Krishna, by hearing your glories, the whole world becomes joyful. The whole world becomes joyful. Rakshamsi bitani dushodravan. Only the demons don't like it. They scatter. But the devotees relish hearing about Krishna. Krishna's activities are so wonderful. Everything from his birth to his cowherding days to his residence in Mathura, and killing of Kamsa, to his pastimes in Dwarkadham, or from another point of view, his activities as a king, as Lord Ramchandra, his activities as Kurmavatar, his activities as half-lion, half-man, Sringadev, all wonderful activities of Krishna. And by hearing these activities, the heart becomes purified, the mind becomes joyful, one becomes enlightened. So, this is the real subject matter for hearing. Therefore, it said, pibata bhagavatam, just drink Srimad Bhagavatam. This is the elixir to cure the disease of birth and death. Yes, there's a question there.
Prabhu, Vedas have been hopping on neti neti. They don't want to define divine energy. Yeah, that's why they use the word, because
if you put the microphone,
once you define energy, cosmic energy, you limit it, it's infinite, you limit it to the meaning of the word you use. Yeah,
no,
this is why you see some of the other religions, they criticize Krishna, because the scriptures say Krishna had so many wives, thousands of wives. How do you explain these things?
There's two questions. There's the how do we explain how Krishna had thousands of wives, and what about this neti neti and the idea that words limit the absolute? Krishna is unlimited. The absolute is unlimited, and our words may be imperfect. But when Krishna appears in transcendental sound, that sound has unlimited capability. It's not a limited thing. The sounds, just like this sound, Coca-Cola, it's limited, and by chanting Coca-Cola, you can chant till your throat is dry, but you won't get a Coke. But when you chant Hare Krishna, Krishna is dancing on the tip of your tongue. Abhinatan namanamino. There's no difference between Krishna, the sound, and Krishna, the personality of Godhead. So the same is true of the Vedic sound. It's called Shabda Brahma. Brahma, or the absolute truth, in the form of sound. So the Vedic sound is beyond the realm of limitation. We can, with our limited minds, we say, oh, sound is limited, words are limited. But the Vedic sound is defined as being Shabda Brahma, unlimited sound. So Krishna, or the Absolute, can appear in sound. If you say he can't, then you're imposing the limitation. The Absolute cannot do X. That's your limitation. But we say, no, the Absolute Truth can do anything. He appears in sound. All of his unlimited Nijasarva Shakti, all of his unlimited energies are present in the transcendental sound. And therefore, by hearing this sound, people realize the absolute truth. The neti neti means not this, not that. This is the speculative way to understand the Supreme. Just if you wanted to say, you know, I'm going somewhere. Let's say I say I'm going somewhere. Where are you going? I say, well, not New York. Not Paris. Not Frankfurt. Not Bombay. Not Fiji. Not Dubai. Okay? So now you have a clearer idea of where I'm going. At least you know where I'm not going. But that doesn't tell you where I am going. You've just eliminated not this, not this, not this, not this. So these speculative philosophers, they try to understand the absolute truth by negation. He's not limited. He's not material. He's not this. He's not that. So that gives you something. At least we know, all right, that's some knowledge. He's not material. He's not limited. But what is he? That they don't know by this process of 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18. That will take millions of years. But from Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita, we get positive information what God is. And we just have to take it. Then we know. As for Krishna having thousands of wives, well, we just said that God is unlimited. What's a thousand wives? And why only a thousand? He can have millions of wives. What's the problem? In this world, for a man to maintain one wife is a big deal. But for Krishna, he can have thousands or millions of wives. There's no difficulty. Does that answer the question?
Yeah, yes. Thank you.
Yes. Just be loud, the microphone. Can I explain to you the story of creation? Yeah, basically Krishna creates everything. That's the story. But if you want to read the story, you know, that's the quick thing. Then we can expand it and say that Krishna expands himself as the Purusha avatars, Mahavishnu, Garbhadakshaya Vishnu, and so on. Then the Kshirdakshaya Vishnu expands as Brahma. He's the engineer. He actually creates. Krishna supplies the ingredients for the creation. And then he inspires Brahma. You do the engineering work. I don't want to bother with this. You do it. That's all described in various places in Srimad Bhagavatam, especially in the second canto.
Thank you. Okay?
And then third canto also. It's these things are, it's not just described on the first day he did this, on the second day he did that. But scientifically, how the different elements expand from one another, how Krishna exfoliates the universe, as it were. These things are described in great detail.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, give
me
a shot.
Okay. In the Gita, Krishna says that he... Okay. In the Gita, Krishna says that he's the author, the compiler, and the knower of the Veda. So at the same time, Vyasadeva is an incarnation of God. He's the compiler. So how is it possible he didn't know? He was unsatisfied, and he didn't know that he should have, you know...
These are Krishna's pastimes.
He should have, you know, described his own pastimes.
Vyasadeva, he does. This is described by Vyasadeva in the first canto. But in so many ways, and we could just have it that Vyasadeva wrote it, but for our instruction, he performs this pastime of not being satisfied and wondering and so on. It's for our benefit. so many things. Why didn't Krishna do it this way? Why didn't Krishna do it that way? He likes to create a pastime. A subject, again, a subject matter. Sometimes Prabhupada said that Krishna appears in this world just to create a subject matter for hearing. If Krishna doesn't appear, then there's nothing to talk about. So Krishna appears just to create a subject matter. So this is part of that subject matter. Is that okay? Mm-hmm. Anything else? Vyasadeva plays like a conditioned soul. Shall we stop here? Yeah, all right. Thank you all very much. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Samaveta Bhaktavrinda ki jai, Gorkhamanande. Hare Krishna.
Are you going to have question and answer session afterwards?
Yes, I think.